Hello and thanks for joining us from the shores of the South China Sea. I'm Jeremy Hubbard here tonight on the beach at Phan Thiet, Vietnam for a sort of homecoming. Fact is, this country was home for tens of thousands of U.S. service members who reluctantly moved here more than 40 years ago to fight the Vietnam War. We have returned with them here for the first time since that war so they can confront the past and confront the war that they still fight in their minds every day of their lives. This is hardly the image of a war-torn country. Doesn't seem like a place ripped apart by a conflict that brought millions of strangers to these shores, many of whom never made it back home. No, instead, this place looks more like a tourist attraction where beachgoers sunbathe in the shadows of thriving big cities like Nha Trang, where commerce flows as freely as the waters of the muddy Mekong River near Can Tho. No, this is not at all the image of a war-torn country, which is why this all looks so unrecognizable. To a group of U.S. veterans.
These people, this is just like going down the street for them.
Returning here to Vietnam for the very first time since the war.
I've been waiting many years to come back here and take a look at this.
Richard Bentley can still remember the sound of the bomb blasts.
They knocked us out of the beds. They were so close, so close.
He knew it would be tough to return here alone.
Blink.
So he brought his wife along for support. He wanted her to see the place he saw as a 20-year-old draftee, the place that changed his life forever. Rich was a cook in the Army, a support guy. He didn't think he'd see much death and destruction, but that all changed the minute he set foot in Vietnam.
I think that the first day of his tour here made him who he was, because he said he got off the truck and there were rows and rows of bodies.
That happened right here at the Cu Chi Army Airfield in southern Vietnam, where Rich was stationed.
This is as close as we can get.
So when he knew he was coming back to Vietnam, he prepared.
Yeah, straight ahead.
Yep.
That's straight ahead.
By finding an old map of the airfield, even located it on GPS.
All right.
What he wasn't prepared for was the feeling.
Airborne, sir.
I'd say airborne, but I don't know. Appreciate it.
It's all right.
Now his sunglasses hide the tears as he shows his wife the very place he's been talking about all this time.
We need you.
I'm here.
There was a time Richard Bentley never wanted to come back here, but more than 40 years after the war, returning fills a void.
I don't know, I feel like it's my 20th birthday back here.
But even now, he can't enjoy the moment for long.
You made it.
I know.
Within just a couple of minutes,
hello.
The guard comes over and tells us to stop photographing Richard's old airbase, which now belongs to the Communist Vietnamese Army. All Richard could get was this one good snapshot of the front gate. But it doesn't matter, because at least he made it here.
It's great. I feel like the circle is complete, you know. Circle came around and I'm right here.
Completing that circle is the idea behind return visits like this. Vietnam Battlefield Tours is a nonprofit run by Vietnam veterans that brings back veterans every year to find the places that forged who these people became.
These guys never met each other before, most of them. And when they leave, they're just like they've known each other forever. They have something in common. And they just, you can see them kind of relax. And you can see them, they reminisce. It's really nice to see that.
A weight lifted.
This is great.
After a long journey, 8,000 miles.
You only got so much life left. This will be the memory I'll carry with me.
Thank you.
And more than 40 years in the making. Everything about Vietnam is foreign to the returning U.S. veterans, and that makes the simplest things fascinating. From the way the locals harvest rice near the town of Vai Tan, just as they have for centuries, to the water buffalo roaming in a herd right alongside the highway. A captivating country from both above
Okay, let's roll.
And down below, This is U.S. Army veteran Mike Herndon, who couldn't wait to crawl through these elaborate tunnels used by the enemy to hide out during the war.
Oh, we're already here.
The dark and the dirt and the bats don't bother him a bit.
Picture of the bat right above your head, Ron.
He is dead set on covering as much ground as possible during this trip.
I'm coming the easy way.
Since he only saw Vietnam by air 45 years ago as a crew member on a helicopter ambulance.
I've seen more on the ground in Vietnam in the last 4 days than I saw in 2 years that I was here. Oh, yeah.
For veterans like Mike, there isn't much time to soak in this experience, unlike their lengthy tours of duty during the war.
This is smaller.
This return to Vietnam is just 14 days long, and there is a lot to squeeze in.
We are standing among the former South Vietnamese President Palace.
So many places to see that are now synonymous with the war. The last time they saw the former home of the South Vietnamese president, it was in these old black and white photos showing enemy tanks crashing through the gates 40 years ago as Saigon fell. A few blocks away, this apartment rooftop looks nondescript until you realize it is the same one from the most iconic photo of the fall of Saigon. Evacuees trying to board a U.S. helicopter just before communist North Vietnamese troops overran the city.
We're at the Thuy Hoa Air Base.
On the coast, they see an Air Force base built and used by Americans during the war. But the current occupants, the Vietnamese military, have surrounded the place with their version of barbed wire, chunks of broken glass. But those are some of the very few reminders of the Vietnam War these days. As these U.S. veterans crisscross this once dangerous countryside, their biggest hazard now is the four-legged kind. Or trying to dodge an unusual highway danger. That stuff you see on the road there is actually the local rice crop, laid out to dry right in the middle of traffic.
3 or 5 days they dry in the sun.
Only in dusty old war museums do they find any lingering reminders of why they were here and how some didn't want them here at all. No formal mention of anything good done by U.S. forces during the war.
I haven't heard anybody say that the Americans started anything or left anything of value. It's just we've been completely deleted from the picture. And it sort of that sort of bothers me a little bit because I know that we did leave something.
Hello.
Hello.
What's your name?
My name Tex. What's your name?
Maybe goodwill is what they left behind.
I live here 1967.
Most everywhere they go now, they encounter friendly people.
Hello.
Hello.
Locals eager to share in their way of life.
Well, I enjoy the people. I enjoy the processes that go on here. I just like it.
Now, is this Buddhist? Is that correct? Hindu.
Just try to imagine a U.S. service member saying they liked Vietnam the first time they came.
50 years is a long time.
But now, as one veteran told us, when you're not being shot at, there is so much more to enjoy.
It's a whole new, different perspective.
Welcome back as we return to Vietnam for the first time with a group of veterans that first served here more than 40 years ago. You know, at the time they couldn't imagine ever coming back here. They couldn't wait to leave. But a growing number of Vietnam veterans is returning here to live full time, including a man we discovered who packed up his life in Colorado to start a brand new one over here. In the Vietnamese coastal town of Da Nang, a tourist spot where there's so much local culture, it literally oozes from the infrastructure. Duet! We found a Vietnam veteran who's become so immersed in this country.
I like it here.
He never plans to leave here.
Well, I came over here looking for my past, but I really found my future.
Bill Irvin had a mustache on his face and a chip on his shoulder when he joined the Marines back in 1968. He wanted to help stop communist aggression in Vietnam. So it is ironic that he now calls that very communist country home.
The war is over and life goes on.
It took about 30 years for him to first come back here. Too many memories. Bill suffers from PTSD, but back in the 90s, he started leading tour groups for returning veterans, and he liked it here. And then a life change back home in Colorado brought about a big decision.
After my wife died, about 2 years later, I decided
Yeah, I'm going to move over.
That was 7 years ago. Bill now lives in Da Nang full-time, year-round. And he's not alone.
There's probably 40 American veterans that I know that live over here. It makes you realize that you're not just totally crazy.
Hard to believe a place so connected with such a painful part of his life could now be the source of so much solace. But Bill noticed something after moving here. He actually thinks less about the Vietnam War now than he ever did back home in the U.S.
You know, you got this big bubble that's been inside of you for 40 years, and it's a good place to let that go.
Vietnam soon brought about another surprise, too.
I got married in Da Nang in a dress and rubber shoes.
A few years back, Bill reconnected with On, a tour guide he'd met years earlier. They fell in love and got married.
And you've never met a man like me before, right?
Never.
The first time he came here, Vietnam changed him. Little did that young man with a mustache on his face and a chip on his shoulder realize.
Didn't find what I was looking for, but I found something much better. You again?
How much this place would change him again.
I love it.
When we come back tonight, making good memories in a place where there are so many bad.
When you fly medical evacuation, there are no good days. You know, you're not taking anybody to a birthday party or a wedding. It's either somebody got blown away or somebody's sick, or and that's day after day after day.
Meet the veterans who are experiencing their old war zone and the people who live here now in a way they never imagined was possible. Welcome back. If you ask the veterans we returned to Vietnam with, what are some of their most vivid memories of the time served here, invariably they'll say the children of this war-torn country. So it's no surprise the kids of Vietnam are a priority on this visit as well.
If the canal's that way, then the airfield was this way.
Every single Vietnam veteran on this journey.
North is that way.
Like Army vet Manny Trevino has come here looking for something from the past.
Unbelievable to be here after 45, 47 years.
Maybe it's an old familiar building.
I mean, as soon as I saw the building in the front that said Cho Vi Thanh, I knew that this is where I was.
Or a familiar face.
You recognize any of them?
Or maybe.
Ask them where the second Army hospital was.
They want what Army nurse Joyce Bowles wants.
I wanted to come this time just to know that I do have closure. And this is good for me.
But every single veteran has also come here to finally make some good memories in Vietnam. And what better place to do that than here?
We are at an orphanage.
So many Americans who served here have fond memories of the children of Vietnam.
The young guy is 6 years old.
And some are making fresh memories now, too.
I was listening to, like, Louis and Manny and Rick. They have good stories. They had some good days. You know, they would go into the village and the kids would come up and greet them. When you fly medical evacuation, there are no good days. You know, you're not taking anybody to a birthday party or a wedding. It's either somebody got blown away or somebody's sick, or and that's day after day after day.
Oh, this is fantastic. Always when I see these little kids, it touches my heart.
But on this day, four decades later, something different. At this home near the village of Vai Tan, a room full of kids of all ages.
This is pencil sharpener for the pencils.
No, no, okay. Yes, they know that.
Who can relate to what it means to be searching for something.
Maybe half orphans.
So these veterans just wanted to help in some small way with a smile or a hug.
Hi. Oh, very shy.
Just as they did all those years ago.
These young kids, they grow up. Some have family, some don't have family. But they need to know that there are people in the world who care about them. And I do.
I saw so many of them like that, being that we traveled to different Vietnamese villages.
46 years ago, as an Army advisor to the South Vietnamese, not far from this orphanage, Manny Trevino got to know children like these. He played with them and held them in his hands and always wondered what happened to them. For Marine Bob Burke, his reasons for wanting to visit kids in places like this are much more personal.
I spent 5 years in one when I was 10 to I was 15. So I know what it feels like. I know what it's like. It's tough.
Toiletries and school supplies and candy are enough to make these children happy.
A lot of people in this country need a lot of help.
But surprisingly, it's something else they cherished even more.
I have so many pictures, and I just develop extra ones for the kids. Just let them have it.
Old pictures, grainy prints from the 1960s of kids. Photos of children playing during tough times. These children closely study each face, each photo, a lesson in their local history, maybe even their family history.
We all care for them.
A gift from the people who witnessed that history and who will never forget the kids they met along the way.
I would not have traded this whole trip for anything in the world. Yeah, this is all good.
Hard to forget the children of Vietnam who touched their lives more than 40 years ago, just as they do still today.
You have to get out in the countryside to see the familiarity.
When you get shot.
If you're in the city, you're not going to ever recognize where you were. But you come out here, you can find it.
Like Marine Ed Tex Steitler did 48 years ago.
I was 20 years old at the time.
It must be a very strange feeling to walk in the exact spot.
I got hit with one shot right there.
Where it happened.
I remember sticking my tongue way up and going, this ain't good, you know.
It was September 21st, 1967. Someone snapped this picture right afterward.
I was very lucky that I'm loud and talking all the time, and I had my mouth open. And I turned, and the bullet hit me under the jaw, came out my mouth.
Tex broke his jaw, lost some teeth, and was soon on his way home after a year in Vietnam.
I was lucky. Very lucky.
You would think what happened here to him nearly a half century ago would be the cause of the PTSD that has plagued Tex for decades.
Hello.
And even affected his career as a school teacher.
And my issue was primarily anger. And I was in seven different schools in four different school districts over dealing with authority. You know, every time I get a principal I didn't like, I'd say, screw you, I'm out of here, I'm going somewhere else.
But it is not his own injury that haunts him.
Well, my squad leader was killed January 30th, 67, and he was a really neat guy.
Charles Esters Jr. was just a teenager when he was killed by small arms fire here in southern Vietnam. And watching it happen has profoundly affected Tex.
When he was shot, I guess we were probably in a state of shock for a month.
It stays with you, and it is the kind of thing that changes you. And if you ask the veterans on this trip, it doesn't get any easier to deal with.
You get in depression, and I find maybe the older I'm getting, the worse it can get, and it can really be difficult.
I feel nervous a little bit.
Somehow, you learn to live with that depression and those painful memories, Army vet Luis Reyna told us.
I left Vietnam 46 years ago. The memories that I went through here, it will never go away.
We're here.
Maybe it's because these guys have embraced the idea that what they've gone through pales next to what the families of those 58,000 U.S. service members who died or went missing in Vietnam still go through every day.
Private First Class Thomas Hanratty has been reported missing in action.
Like Bessie Langdon of Beulah, Colorado, still clinging to the telegram sent home from when her 20-year-old brother was killed in a helicopter crash.
Helicopter pilot had keyed the mic, and they said they could hear someone screaming, Mom, 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 Mom. And that was really tough to hear.
To this day, his remains are still somewhere in Vietnam.
Life never was the same again. It's, you know, for us, it never was.
Or David Herdlicka of Littleton.
It's just been such a, you know, ride up and down emotionally.
He was just 7 years old when his father, David Herdlicka Sr., was shot down over Laos and taken prisoner.
As a little seven-year-old kid, I just understood it. Hey, my dad was caught by some bad guys, and he'll be home at the end of the war.
But his dad never came back, and he will likely never know what happened to him.
Anybody that grows up without a parent one side or the other, it leaves you a little lopsided, you know, and it's tough on Father's Day when you're going, you know, kind of. But
that is why for those like Tex who survived, there is so much guilt that they ever made it out of here alive, and a never-ending loyalty to their brothers who didn't.
We remember these guys every day. It's not an occurrence where you just once a year at Memorial Day or Veterans Day, you remember them. It's not that. You remember them every day.
Remembering those who never made it back from Vietnam, a daily duty for those lucky enough to come back here now. and we've been so fortunate to join them too. I'm Jeremy Hubbard from Fan Thiet Vietnam. Thanks so much for joining us tonight.